All right. Thank you guys for joining once again to our weekly Bible study of the Dead Sea Scroll, centered on the Dead Sea Scroll faith. Last week we had an amazing study where we went through the prophecies of Levi and Naphtali, the sons of Jacob. They wrote down their prophecies in books, and we have copies of these that have been preserved for us through the Christians. I copied these books and preserved copies for us, and so we also have some of these in the Dead Sea Scrolls as well, but in fragments. But it indicates that it's a very ancient writing, and it wasn't invented by Christians. It was an ancient Jewish writing. And so, however, there's 12 testaments, and it takes a while to go through them. So far, we've gone through in our Bible studies together, we went through Reuben's, Simeon's, Issachar's, Levi's, and Naphtali's. That's 5. This week, we're going to do at least Judah's Testament and Joseph's Testament, but we're also going to, hopefully, we're going to try to do Zebulun's Testament. So that would bring us to 8 of the Testaments, and then that would leave us the 4 remaining ones. But we'll see what we can cover in today's. Now, if you guys have questions at any time throughout this study, feel free to ask. And when I see those questions, I will answer whatever it's about. It might be about a topic I bring up in the study, or if it's just something that comes to your mind about something that, on a completely different issue. Not related to the study we're doing, but just something that's really on your mind and that you would like an answer for, please share, and I will try to address it at a good stopping point. So, with that said, I'm gonna begin going through the Testament of Judah. So, Judah starts out after gathering his family together. He says, "Hearken, my children, to Judah, your father. I was the 4th son born to my father Jacob, and Leah, my mother, named me Judah, saying, I give thanks to the Lord because he hath given me a 4th son also." This matches what Genesis says as well for Judah's name. So Judah, he talks about how his youth, and he says, "I was swift in my youth and obedient to my father in everything, and I honored my mother and my mother's sister." So he honored his mother, Leah, and his mother's sister, Rachel, because he knew that his father loved her, and so he honored them both. Now, when Judah became a man, he says that his father blessed him, saying, "Thou shalt be a king, prospering in all things." So basically, Jacob understood. He knew in advance Jacob knew in advance that Judah would eventually become a king. This was a prophecy that Jacob received. Now, let's see here. Someone's commenting on Facebook. I'm going to see if they're okay. Yeah, he wants to join in. One second. Okay, there we go. So your question, there was a question about Anunnaki, who they were. Well, there's the Sumerian accounts. There's Sumerian accounts of their belief about what happened, how their creation happened, their gods, the flood. So the Anunnaki is the Sumerian account of the whole episode that the Bible reports on. Now I'd have to look. Let me look quickly on the Anunnaki. Just submit, you know, I can answer it because I don't remember Let's see here. It just seems like they are angels, heavenly beings, watchers. So that's what I would say. Yeah, it says I guess it's a Babylonian document, the Epic of Creation, that there are 300 Igigu, which the scholars say is connected to Anunnaki, apparently, of heaven, 300 of them, and we know there's the 200 watchers, so it's probably their connection there, but I'd have to do more study to make sure. I'm not well learned in the Sumerian ideas, and yeah, there's nothing in the Dead Sea Scrolls about the Anunnaki or the Enlil or Enki. Those are Sumerian ideas, and that language is Sumerian. There's no Hebrew words that mention those names or individuals. And yeah, the Anunnaki were not creators. Only Yahuwah is our creator. So I would avoid people who would try to make too much of the Sumerian stuff. There's probably some very good parallels between Sumerian thoughts and the Bible's thoughts, but we have to remember that they've corrupted the truth. Same thing with the Egyptians. The Egyptians have some truths, but they've corrupted it through their passing on of the traditions. So I'm going to continue with the book that Judah wrote in his own words. Now remember, as I said last week, the original version of the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs was much longer. This version that I'm reading from is the shortened version that the scribes created. So these aren't the actual words themselves that the 12 sons of Jacob wrote. They are a summary, a condensed version of the original text. So keep that in mind. If some of the language seems more modern, then it may be for that reason, that those actual words were not written by the 12 sons, but the thoughts and ideas and concepts were the same as what the patriarch wrote. So we can trust what these testaments say, even if the exact words were not used. So to give an example of how that would work is I'm trying to think of a good example. It's just basically, if you reword things, you can reword things to make it say the same thing, but just in a shorter way. As long as you're trying to be faithful to the meaning of the text, you can shorten it while preserving the same idea. And that's what happened to this document. So, let's see here. One second, let me get back to my place. Okay, there we are. Judah says that he talks about how he was blessed with powerful strength in his youth, and that it was Yahuwah, God, who gave him this power. He says, "And the Lord showed me favor in all my works, both in the field and in the house. I know that I raised a hind and caught it, and prepared the meat for my father, and he did eat. And the roes I used to master in the chase, and overtake all that was in the plains. A wild mare I overtook and caught it, and tamed it." So he tamed a wild horse. "I slew a lion and plucked a kid out of its mouth. I took a bear by its paw and hurled it down the cliff, and it was crushed. I outran the wild boar. And seizing it as I ran, I tear it in sunder. a leopard in Hebron leaped upon my dog, and I caught it by the tail and hurled it on the rocks, and it was broken in twain. Right there, we're seeing it's okay to have dogs. Some people teach that dogs are unclean. We shouldn't have them as pets. But we see here Judah has a dog, and dogs are very useful for watching and protecting if you train them. And he says, I found a wild ox feeding in the fields, and seizing it by the horns and whirling it round and stunning it, I cast it from me and slew it. And then he goes on and talks about his success when he's fighting humans who are his enemies. He says, and when the two kings of the Canaanites came and sheathed in armor against our flocks and much people with them, single-handed I rushed upon the king of Hazor and smote him on the greaves and dragged him down, so I slew him. And the other, the king of Tapua, as he sat upon his horse, I slew, and so I scattered all his people. Achor, the king, a man of great stature, I found, hurling javelins before and behind as he sat on horseback. And I took up a stone of 60 pounds weight and hurled it, and smote his horse and killed it. And I fought with him, I fought with another for 2 hours, and I clave his shield in twain, and I chopped off his feet, and killed him. And as I was stripping off his breastplate, behold, 9 men, his companions, began to fight with me. And I wound my garment on my hand, and I slung stones at them, and killed 4 of them, and the rest fled. And Jacob my father slew Beelisath, king of all the kings, a giant in strength, 12 cubits high. And fear fell upon them, and they ceased warring against us. Therefore my father was free from anxiety in the wars when I was with my brethren. For he saw in a vision concerning me that an angel of might followed me everywhere, that I should not be overcome. So, also to let you know, this account of Judah's war, fighting these enemies, it's found in the book of Jubilees. So Jubilees confirms it. It's the second witness. And then we also have what seems to be a excerpt from the lost book of Jacob that the rabbis preserved for us in a midrash. Normally what the rabbis preserve for us is not to be trusted, but sometimes they have some good stuff in their midrashes from the Apocrypha. And so they had an account of this war in great detail in one of the midrashes. And the book of Jacob was once existing. It was written by Jacob. The book of Jubilees tells us it's of its existence. And Jubilees tells us of the existence of other books, like Abraham, the book that Abraham wrote, the book that Noah wrote. And those books that Abraham and Noah wrote were found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. It's called the Genesis Apocryphon. Incomplete, because it was fragmentary, but it confirms that Jubilees is reliable. So when Jubilees says that Jacob also wrote a book, we can trust what he said. And so Jacob's book, from my understanding, had also an account of this war that Judah speaks about. And he says, Judah said here that he was so powerful and successful because an angel of power was with him and gave him that strength. So this kind of teaches us that our strength does not come from our own, but we have angels that assist us. And just like with Samson, how did Samson have so much strength? Remember when his hair was cut off, just like my hair, I have long hair. If his hair had been cut off, he lost his strength. But that's illogical in the normal thinking of science, because your hair is not linked to your strength. However, because we have to understand that there's also angels and there's a spiritual realm connected to the physical world, it influences the science of it. It doesn't contradict science, but it makes it more complicated. So the science of man says that doesn't make sense. To cut someone's hair off cuts them of their power. But in a spiritual way, that can be scientific, because the spiritual world affects the physical world. And so there must have been an angel with Samson, commanded by God, you stay with Samson so long as his hair is long and not cut. But if the hair is cut, then you must leave him. That is your order. So we see that so much is going on behind the scenes that we're not aware of. And so people are deceived into thinking everything they do is of their own abilities and own awesomeness. But in reality, everything we have comes from God. Every breath we take, every step we do, we can't do anything without Him first giving us that ability to do it. And our intelligence comes from His design. He helps, the way I view how we are is He designed our bodies sort of like computer programs, and how it works is sort of like a code where all you do, there's the only thing that you do is you make a choice about yes or no. Okay, you make a choice. You say yes, that's what I'm going to do, or no, I'm not going to do that. Everything else is not in your power. The program you were designed with of your mind is what is making it happen. For example, if I were to tell you guys something, like if I were to say something random, like I gotta think of something. Rainbow. If I were to say rainbow right now, when I said that word, every one of you probably had a thought. But think for a moment, what was the thought that you had? And it's not the same thought for everyone. Did you think about which thought you were going to have, or did the thought just come to you? And you'll recognize that our thoughts just come to us. We might be looking for thoughts, but we can't make the thoughts come to us. We receive the thoughts from our brains, and then when the thought comes to us, another thought comes to our mind, how are we going to react to this? And then the reaction is yes or no, and we make that choice, and then we decide to do what the choice that was brought before us allowed us to do. So we don't realize how little we are in actual control of. And this is just a testimony. Judah's words are a testimony to our inferiority, to how much greater the rest of the world is. And The Shepherd of Hermas, which I consider scripture, it's a very powerful and amazing book. It teaches that every person has two angels, sort of similar to the good angel, bad angel thing, you know, on the shoulders. That might be where this idea came from, that we've heard by other people. It might be derived from The Shepherd of Hermas, possibly, because it speaks of something very similar to that idea. It's not like two little angels on your shoulders. It doesn't say the shoulders, but it's two angels who suggest to you thoughts. And you have to choose between which angel you're going to follow, the good angel or the bad angel. And so this just kind of confirms what Judah is telling us. Now, going back to what Judah says, he says, and in the south there came upon us a greater war than that in Shechem. Now remember, in Shechem there was a war with the Shechemites. But so he says, and I joined in battle array with my brethren, and pursued 1,000 men, and slew of them 200 men and 4 kings. And I went up upon the wall, and I slew 4 mighty men. And so we captured Hazor, and took all the spoil. On the next day, we departed to Aritan, a city strong and walled and inaccessible, threatening us with death. But I and Gad approached on the east side of the city, and Reuben and Levi on the west. And they that were upon the wall, thinking that we were alone, were drawn down against us. And so my brothers secretly climbed up the wall on both sides by stakes, and entered the city while the men knew it not. And we took it with the edge of the sword. And as for those who had taken refuge in the tower, we set fire to the tower and took both it and them. And as we were departing, the men of Tappuah seized our spoil, and seeing This we fought with them, and we slew them all and recovered our spoil. And when I was at the waters of Cozibah, the men of Jobel came against us to battle, and we fought with them and routed them, and their allies from Shiloh we slew, and we did not leave them power to come in against us. And the men of Machir came upon us the fifth day to seize our spoil, and we attacked them and overcame them in fierce battle, for there was a host of mighty men amongst them. And we slew them before they had gone up the ascent. And when we came to their city, their women rolled upon us stones from the brow of the hill on which the city stood. And I and Simeon hid ourselves behind the town, and seized upon the heights and destroyed the city also. I'm going to get to, if people are saying something, I'm going to check what it says in a second. And then he says, and the next day it was told us that the king of the city of Gaash with a mighty host was coming against us. I, therefore, and Dan feigned ourselves to be Amorites, and as allies went into their city. And in the depth of night our brethren came, and we opened to them the gates, and we destroyed all the men in their substance, and we took for a prey all that was theirs, and their three walls we cast down. And we drew near to Thamna, where was all the substance of the hostile kings. Then being insulted by them, I was therefore wroth, and rushed against them to the summit, and they kept slinging against me stones and darts. And had not Dan my brother aided me, they would have slain me. We came upon them therefore with wrath, and they all fled. And passing by another way, they besought my father, and he made peace with them. And we did to them no hurt, and they became tributary to us, and we restored to them their spoil. And I built Thamna, and my father built Rabael. I was 20 years old when this war befell, and the Canaanites feared me and my brethren. Okay, I'll stop here for a second. The rainbow that I mentioned, that is a example of, in scripture we see that as a symbol that God decided to use with us. For the covenant that he made with us, that he wouldn't flood us. It also a symbol of peace, and for the sinful people, it's a symbol of gay rights. And so there's always a difference of perception based on what people's beliefs are. But just to reinforce my point of how we don't control our thoughts, yes, and the covenant was with the animals, not to destroy the animals either. When I was looking for an idea to pop into my head, I was thinking, what's a good thing to say? It wasn't my choice for a rainbow to pop into my head. That was a thought that came to my head, not by my choice. I had other thoughts prior to that that came to my head, and I said, no, I don't want to say that. I'm going to look for another thought. And so I was looking for another thought. The thought came to me, rainbow, but I didn't choose, let me think about rainbow. Rainbow came to my head as an option of a possible thing to say. And then I was like, okay, that I want to say that. So I chose to say it. That's how I think our minds work. But so everything I read is an account of Judah's wars, fighting, in-depth detail, which is nowhere mentioned in Genesis. But it's mentioned in the Book of Jubilees, and it's mentioned in these that rabbinic midrash that I mentioned earlier, which is from the book of a preservation of the... Very likely a excerpt from the Book of Jacob, and the Book of Jacob had an account of this. I'm absolutely certain that that's the case, that it had an account of their wars that they fought. And so what's very cool about this account is that it basically tells us advice and strategy of how to fight war. There's some great strategies in here. Defending yourself, protecting the innocent. If you ever find yourself in a difficult situation, people coming to try to kill you, you can use some of reasoning from scripture about how to successfully win against the enemy. Jasher mentions other wars, but there's a lot of differences, and it's a different time period. It doesn't line up. But they must have had it from their oral tradition that there must have been a war, and they try to figure out when did that happen, when was the war, And so they tried to figure out when that was, and they guessed. And they were guessing some of the details. My understanding is Yasher is not a valid document. I've said in other teachings why I don't accept Yasher, but basically there's very little evidence for its ancientness. Some copies of the Bible which quote Yasher, the most ancient copies, don't mention Yasher, like in Book of Joshua. There's no reference in the oldest copies. And Yasher contradicts so many of these other books. And it says some really bizarre things in it that seem completely contrary to the truth. So I can go into more detail in some other teaching about why I don't accept Yasher. But that's kind of the main overview of why I don't. But there's some important lessons we learn from the accounts of the war. Well, first of all, we see a connection with the Temple Scroll. We see, according to the Temple Scroll, that if someone steals something from your nation, that's an act of war. So the nation that steals from your nation are making an act of war and should be fought in war against such a thing as punishment. So we see in the account that Judah gave that some of the men would steal their stuff and then they would fight them in war because of it, because that was an act of war that they were doing. So it gives a lot of insights as to why wars are allowed to be done, how they got started, and then we also see women are participating in war. They're actually assisting their husbands. And so that's why in the Bible, in the Law of Moses, we see so many times that the women are not to be spared. They are to be killed too. But the virgins, the women who are not married to anyone, even if they're not a virgin, the Hebrew word for virgin doesn't necessarily mean virgin. It means someone who's not sexually active. And so the not sexually active women are not in a marriage with anyone. So they're not helping their husbands. The basic idea is a woman who's married to her husband is joined to him. So if the husband is wicked and fighting in war, and the wife does not divorce that man or separate from him, distance herself from him, then she's assisting him. And that's what we see in Judah. These women were helping, trying to throw stones to kill the men. But not just that. That's what the women were doing this time. But in many other wars, what do women do? They help take care of the men. They are helping them get their weapons, helping feed them. They are joined in the war effort. So that's why women are not excluded from that, because they are very much entwined. So this is just an illustration of why the Law of Moses includes women in the destruction command, because they are guilty for participating in the war efforts. See here. And then we also see deception. A lot of people, you know, are iffy on deception. Some people think deception is not okay to do. Lying is wrong always, but deception is not always wrong, because there's a difference between deception and lying. Deception is doing something or saying something that can be interpreted in multiple valid ways, and what you're doing is technically true, or saying is technically true, with the designed intention that people, you're hoping that they don't interpret it the correct way. But you're not saying anything false, and you're not forcing them to believe something false. You're giving them all the true facts, and if they're making assumptions about you, what you're saying or doing, then you're not lying to them, even if you wanted them to make that assumption of you. If you did something in a certain way, hoping that they would draw that conclusion, you didn't lie to them, but you were deceiving them. Just like my dad has sometimes said in the past, we don't do this so much anymore, but we would leave the lights on, or leave the TV on, or music on, if no one's in the house. Why? so that if people passing by, if they hear it, they might think someone's home. But no one's home, but it's not lying because, you know, that's what I'm saying. There's multiple ways of interpreting it. And so in an act of war, or when you're fighting in war, you can deceive the enemy. That's a key strategy. But you're not lying to them. So when they said that they feigned themselves Amorites, they pretended to be Amorites, so they dressed up as Amorites, and they must have said some things that made it sound like they were Amorites, and that they were allies to them, and that's how it ended up happening. We don't have a record of what they actually said, so we can't put to the test, evaluate whether or not they lied or deceived, but we can trust by faith that the righteous men of Jacob did not lie to them, but they said it in a special way that they would conclude, okay, these guys are Amorites, they're allies. But so we see deception very much an important part of war to help in victory. And then it says in one of the maneuvers that they did, they tried to create a diversion. So they went somewhere, two of the brothers, I think it was, they walked over in one place, bringing the attention of everybody else on them, giving their brothers time to sneak on in when no one was looking. So it's all types of strategies which are really valuable for us, especially Israel as a people have to defend the nation of Israel. And so this would really help them learn how to fight war properly. We see that's important. God finds how to fight war important. The Temple Scroll gives us laws for war, and the War Scroll that was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls is a huge prophecy of a future war that's going to happen, and gives detailed instructions of how to fight a war. So we see clear evidence that proper ways to fight war is very much part of God's heart. He finds it important for us. Now I'm going to go and continue studying through with you guys Judah's Testament. Judah, he speaks about how he married a woman from a pagan. He describes his account of how this happened. So he says, after he married Bathsheba, she bare me Er and Onan and Shelah, and two of them the Lord smote. For Shelah lived, and his children are ye. So he's saying, you are the children of Shelah. His children he's talking to. Because if I remember correctly, I have to, let's see, he'll probably explain it later on, but so he says, 18 years my father abode at peace with his brother Esau and his sons with us. After that we came from Mesopotamia from Laban. Let's see here. And when 18 years were fulfilled, in the 40th year of my life, Esau, the brother of my father, came upon us with a mighty and strong people. And Jacob smote Esau with an arrow, and he was taken up wounded on Mount Seir. And as he went, he died at Ananarim, or Ananaram. And we pursued after the sons of Esau. Now they had a city with walls of iron and gates of brass, and we could not enter into it. And we encamped around and besieged it. And when they opened not to us in 20 days, I set up a ladder in the sight of all, and with my shield upon my head I went up, sustaining the assaults of stones upwards of 3 talents weight, and I slew 4 of their mighty men. And Reuben and Gad slew 6 others. And then they asked from us terms of peace, and having taken counsel with our father, we received them as tributaries. And they gave us 500 cores of wheat, 500 baths of oil, 500 measures of wine until the famine when we went down into Egypt. This account of fighting with Esau and his sons is told in greater detail in the Book of Jubilees and in that Midrash that I mentioned by the rabbis, and it was in the Book of Jacob as well. Now, so we see what happened with Esau. He decided to betray his own brother once again. Even though originally they were at peace, eventually Esau, as we learn in Jubilees, Esau did not want to kill his brother at first. He was trying to be at peace with him. Then his own sons threatened to harm him unless he joined them and fight Jacob. And Esau was upset that his sons were doing this. But then he remembered, oh yeah, all the bad things my brother did. He started remembering and getting really angry about what his brother had done to him. And then he's like, you know what? I'm going to kill him for what he did to me. But we see a much clearer account of Esau's fate in these other writings that Genesis just doesn't tell us. So Judah continues, and he talks about, he says, after these things, my son Er took to wife Tamar from Mesopotamia, a daughter of Aram. Now Er was wicked, and he was in need concerning Tamar, because she was not of the land of Canaan. And on the third night, an angel of the Lord smote him. So he was being very wicked, and the angel God sent an angel to kill him because of how evil he was. He had not known her according to the evil, he says, he had not known her according to the evil craftiness of his mother, for he did not wish to have children by her. In the days of the wedding feast, I gave Onan to her in marriage. This is the whole Livret marriage thing, where the brother marries the dead brother to produce seed, because the first brother did not have any children. So I gave Onan to her in marriage, and he also in wickedness knew her not, though he spent with her a year. So he was with her for a whole year, and he wasn't being with her. And then Judah says, when I threatened him, he went in unto her, but he spilled the seed on the ground, according to the command of his mother, and he also died through wickedness. So basically, this was a very wicked thing. Why is it wicked? According to the Book of Tobit, the original law of Moses, which we know, as I proved in other teachings, is the Temple Scroll, the original law of Moses had a command that anyone who does not follow the Levirate marriage, if they disobey those laws, it's a death penalty. If they violate those laws of the Levirate marriage, that's a capital crime. It's like adultery, basically. And so these two men were violating, Er was wicked, but he didn't violate the Levirate marriage thing. But Onan, he was violating it. And so Onan deserved to die for that reason. And that's why he was killed too. Genesis gives that little account of how Onan spilled the seed because he did not want to have children by her. So now then Judah says, and I wished to give Shelah also to her, but his mother did not permit it, for she wrought evil against Tamar, because she was not of the daughters of Canaan, as she also herself was. So basically, Tamar was not a Canaanite, but the woman that Judah married was, and Judah was wrong to do this. They were not supposed to marry Canaanites, but he chose to marry Bathsheba, a Canaanite. And Judah wanted Shelah to be married to Tamar according to the law of Levirate marriage, but his wife refused to allow that to happen. And that's why it was never allowed to be consummated. And then, now Judah, he explains what happened, why he married a wicked Canaanite woman. He says, "I knew that the race of the Canaanites was wicked, but the impulse of youth blinded my mind." Many of us are familiar with that impulse of our youth, which blinded us and made us do stupid things. He says, "When I saw her pouring out wine, owing to the intoxication of wine, was I deceived, and took her, although my father had not counseled." So basically, he got drunk and then married her while he was drunk, which shows that drunkenness is wrong, immoral, and will lead us into major sin. But it also teaches us that even when you're drunk, if you marry someone, it's a legitimate marriage in God's eyes, even though you did not have full control over your actions, you still had control over your actions, and you chose to marry them. We still have a choice when we're drunk. Your choice is not eliminated. It's just so much easier to give in to a choice to do sin at that time, because it's such a stronger, the thoughts in your mind are so much stronger trying to tell you to do it, like screaming at you, do this, do this, do this, and you really want to do it. And so it's so easy to give in to it when you're drunk. And so this teaches us that even when you make poor choices under the influence of something, you're still responsible for your actions. If you get someone pregnant, you have to man up and take care of them as a father. If you marry someone while you were drunk, you've got to man up the responsibility and be the woman's husband. And so Judah continues and he says, "While I was away, she went and took for Shelah a wife from Canaan." Because remember, he said that she did not want her sons to be married to someone who was not a Canaanite. So she said, "Okay, now's the chance. He's not here right now. Shelah, come with me and marry this Canaanite. This nice, beautiful Canaanite woman who will be willing to do all sorts of wicked things with you that Tamar won't." So he went with that woman instead, a woman from Canaan. And Judah says, "And when I knew what she had done, I cursed her in the anguish of my soul. And she also died through her wickedness together with her sons." So his whole family died, essentially, except Shelah. Laura asks, "Is not sleeping with someone a sin to avoid children? Is that a sin?" The context of this is the levirate marriage, which is you are obligated to give children to your dead spouse, to the dead brother. So that was considered such a serious sin. Now what we did see is that Er was not loving his wife, and he was the first one. So it wasn't about levirate marriage in that case, but he was being very evil and cruel and heartless to his wife. So I would say it would be a sin to avoid avoid sex for the purpose of avoiding children if you have a sinful reason that you don't want children with that person. The sinful reason was because she wasn't a Canaanite. That's the reason why Er, her first husband, refused to sleep with her. So we see that if it's for a wicked reason, then it's a sin. But otherwise, we are not commanded, like there's not a law or command that you must have children as much as possible as you can, otherwise you're sin. So I believe it is okay to abstain from sex if you are not ready to have children, or if you have a good reason not to do it, because you don't want children. Even if your other spouse really wants children, but if you have a good reason for not wanting children at this time, then it's not a sin, I don't think. Hopefully that answers that question. Judah says, after these things, while Tamar was a widow, she heard after 2 years that I was going up to shear my sheep, and adorned herself in bridal array, and set in the city a name by the gate. For it was a law of the Amorites that she who was about to marry should sit in fornication 7 days by the gate. So basically, the idea is, why did Judah assume that she was a prostitute when he was walking by? Because there was a custom, a pagan custom in this land, where anyone who was about to be married was to be dressed as a bride in a veil at that gate right there. So when he was walking by, he knew in his mind of that custom, and he saw a woman there, so he assumed that she was a prostitute because she was following the custom. And he says, therefore, being drunk with wine, I did not recognize her. So once again, he's being drunk again. He's having a drunk problem, drinking problem. And he says, because I was drunk, I did not recognize her, and her beauty deceived me through the fashion of her adorning. So he was like, she's really attractive. I want to sleep with her. And his thoughts were so powerful and strong a hold on him because he was drunk, and he couldn't resist it. Well, he could, but he refused to resist those temptations and gave in, and he slept with her. David said, you should always communicate with your spouse about your desire for how many children you want to have, when you want to have them, things like that. You want to discuss that, but you can't always predict the future. Things can change. And so there's always things that will come up which you couldn't have known in the past. And so you always want to be open and talking with people. Talking with your spouse about what's going on in your mind and what you think, what you feel you need to do. You don't want to do something and not tell your spouse. Like you never have sex with your spouse, but you don't tell your spouse why. Then your spouse is going to be thinking, okay, he doesn't love me anymore, or she doesn't love me anymore, or something's wrong. I don't understand why. What's going on? That's really bad. I had issues in my former marriage where my wife was not communicating with me, and that led to some major problems later. Which, if she had just told me how she was feeling, we could have avoided the bad stuff. But in her mind, she was like, I shouldn't have to tell him. He should figure it out on his own. That's a very bad thing to say, but a lot of women, and sometimes men, come to that, say that. They say, I shouldn't have to say that. It's not fair that to make me have to say it. He should know better. Well, maybe he should know better. However, just because he might know better, you have the power to prevent more problems in your marriage. So do it. Try to prevent something bad from happening. Even if your husband or wife should be doing more on their part, you can do your part to make sure absolutely that you prevent a really bad thing in your marriage from happening. And then someone asked about plural marriage. Is that okay under Elohim, under God? I've discussed this in other studies, and I don't believe it is. I believe there is a process, a way for concubine, for a man to have a concubine, but it's a very limited way and not something that's promiscuous, and the man can choose as many concubines as he wants. The concubine has children in the place of the wife as a substitute. If the wife wants, she takes her place and temporarily becomes the man's wife in the place of the real wife to help give children to the wife that can't have children anymore. It's not an additional woman. So it's not like a man has a wife and then he has other women that he can sleep with too on the side. That's not what a concubine is. And that's an evil thing to have mistresses like that. A concubine is a replacement for the sake of giving children to the wife who can't have children. And So the scriptures, I believe, teach monogamy, only one wife, and there's different passages which people appeal to as evidence that that polygamy is not a sin or that it's okay under God's eyes, but I've seen a lot of evidence that that's not the case. One of the main verses that people appeal to is King David. But in the Temple Scroll, we have the fuller law of Moses, which tells us that what King David did was completely wrong. It gives in much greater detail how a king is only allowed to have one wife, and only after she dies can he marry another woman. And it has to be from his tribe, from the Israelites. And there's many other passages. The Messiah has a lot to say about how if you divorce and marry another woman, that's adultery. It would not be adultery if you could have more than one wife. Because if you divorce your first wife, marry a second woman, you can just remarry the first woman. And it wouldn't be adultery. It would be fine. Because marrying a second woman would not be a big issue of being able to reconcile with your first spouse. If, however, polygamy is wrong, then it makes total sense. Because then, just like the law of Moses says, if a woman leaves her husband, is divorced by her husband, marries another man, and then that man divorces her or dies, she's not allowed to return to her first husband because that would be an abomination. The Messiah treats the same thing in his, how he says it, he applies it the same way to if the husband divorces his wife and then marries another wife, he's committed adultery against his first wife. Why? Because he now cannot return to his first wife because it would be an abomination. But if polygamy was okay, then he could and there would be no harm, no foul. And you can find what when the Messiah says this in Matthew chapter 5, I think it is, or maybe it was chapter 7, and then in Matthew chapter 19, and there's also in Luke somewhere, and in Mark, the parallel accounts. And it also says, in addition, it says, and the man who marries the woman that was divorced also commits adultery with her. So it's both, according to the Messiah. And there's so many other passages. Dead Sea Scrolls are clear on it, in like the Damascus document. I can go on in another teaching, perhaps, of so much greater evidence. And as I said, there's certain passages which people appeal to, which I could address in other teachings. But that's hopefully that satisfactorily deals with it in this one. So continuing with what Judah said, he says, "I turned aside to her." He's talking about Tamar, his daughter-in-law that he's sleeping with because he's drunk. He says, "I turned aside to her and said," oh, wait, he's telling how he's about to be with her. He says, "I turned aside to her and said, let me go in unto thee. And she said, what wilt thou give me? And I gave her my staff and my girdle and the diadem of my kingdom in pledge. And I went in unto her and she conceived. And not knowing what I had done, wished to slay her," because you know when we're drunk we often forget what we did. So he wished to slay her, or like he I think he remembered that he slept with a woman, but he didn't remember what he told her, he didn't remember everything that happened. So he, as we see in Genesis, he wanted to kill her. And that's according with Jubilees what he wanted to do. Remember, he wanted to burn her with fire. That's what Jubilees says, that that's the proper punishment for someone who is whoring. And Judah says, but she privily sent my pledges and put me to shame. And when I called her, I heard also the secret words which I spoke when lying with her in my drunkenness. And I could not slay her, because it was from the Lord. For I said, lest haply she did it in subtlety, having received the pledge from another woman. But I came not again near her while I lived, because I had done this abomination in all Israel. Basically, he's saying he was doubting what she was saying at first, because she said, I slept with you, and he said, no, I'm not sure. Maybe she got it from some other woman. But then she told him the words that he said to her in private. And so then he knew, oh, okay, this happened. Because there's no way she could have known about that. And no one else could have told her but me. So she's right, I did this. And he was put to shame because of it. He knew he had done major wrong and that she was more righteous than him. He said that in Genesis. And so he said he came down again near her while he lived. He says, moreover, they who were in the city said that there was no harlot in the gate, because she came from another place and sat for a while on the gate. And I thought that no one knew that I had gone in to her. And after this, we came into Egypt to Joseph because of the famine. I was 40 and 6 years old, and 70 and 3 years lived I in Egypt. So we're seeing a lot more detail about the chronology and timeline from Judah's words. Now, then Judah says, gives us advice about how to obey and be righteous. He says, now I command you, my children, hearken to Judah your father, and keep my sayings to perform all the ordinances of the Lord, and to obey the commands of God. And walk not after your lusts, nor in the imaginations of your thoughts, in haughtiness of heart, and glory not in the deeds and strength of your youth, for this also is evil in the eyes of the Lord. Since I also gloried that in wars no comely woman's face ever enticed me, and reproved Reuben my brother concerning Bilhah, the wife of my father, the spirits of jealousy and of fornication arrayed themselves against me until I lay with Bathsheba the Canaanite and Tamar, who was a spouse to my sons. So basically he was like boasting and, or not boasting, maybe boasting, that he was basically like saying to Reuben, you fool, you know, you sleep with Bilhah, how could you do such a thing? But then, in his mind, he was secretly aroused by the idea, and then, eventually, the spirits of jealousy and of fornication found a weakness in him, drunkenness, as we said earlier. While he was drunk, it got into him, those spirits, and led him to sin, just like his brother Reuben. And so now he realized, okay, I'm just as bad as my brother Reuben. So he said, for I said to my father-in-law, I will take counsel with my father, and so will I take thy daughter. And he was unwilling, but he showed me a boundless store of gold in his daughter's behalf, for he was a king. And he adorned her with gold and pearls, and caused her to pour out wine for us at the feast with the beauty of wine, of woman. And the wine turned aside my eyes, and pleasure blinded my heart, and I became enamored of, and I lay with her, and transgressed the commandment of the Lord and the commandment of my fathers, and I took her to wife. And the Lord rewarded me according to the imagination of my heart, inasmuch as I had no joy in her children. When it says rewarded, that's a deceptive word. It makes it sound positive. But reward in older times, because this is an older translation, it can mean a result of what you did, giving what you deserve. And so he was rewarded with having no joy in his in the children of Bathsheba, because she was a Canaanite and their children, it was not a good family. So basically, if you marry someone sinfully and they're a very bad person, you're going to have a stressful and difficult marriage and life. But that's your fault. You're reaping what you sowed. And that's what Judah found out in his experience. Painfully, he found that out. So he warns us not to follow his ways. He says, be not drunk with wine, for wine turneth the mind away from the truth, and inspires the passion of lust, and leadeth the eyes into error. For the spirit of fornication hath wine as a minister to give pleasure to the mind, for these two also take away the mind of man. For if a man drink wine to drunkenness, it disturbeth the mind with filthy thoughts leading to fornication, and heateth the body to carnal union. And if the occasion of the lust be present, he worketh the sin and is not ashamed. Such is the inebriated man, my children, for he who is drunken reverenceth, or respects, no man. For lo, it made me also to err, so that I was not ashamed of the multitude in the city, in that before the eyes of all I turned aside unto Tamar, and I wrought a great sin, and I uncovered the covering of my son's shame. So we're seeing, he speaks from experience. He knows being what drunkenness can do. It ruins people's lives. And we see that today all the time. We see so many people's lives and families ruined by drunkenness. So let's heed his warning, and let's not experiment with drunkenness. If you have young children, make sure they're familiar with Judah's words so that they learn from his mistakes and they don't do the same thing. You know, make sure to teach the young ones and to teach the youth about these lessons. This is very important information that a lot of people are not getting. It's just like when you have your own family, you teach your children what you learned from your life. I had a horrible thing happen to me in my youth. Don't let this happen to you guys. It's the same thing. That's what we're learning from Judah, was being a good father and trying to tell his family how to avoid the problems that he had in his life. And so many times, children think they know better than their parents and think, that's not going to happen to me, or that's only because he was stupid or something. My parent was dumb. He did it wrong. But we always underestimate, and we don't realize, and then afterwards we realize, okay, my parents were right, and I was in the wrong. I should have listened to them. So many times we've seen that happen. So let's hopefully we can convince our families in future and future generations to heed the warnings that we give them about the mistakes we've made and the mistakes that the men of Scripture made. And he says, much discretion needeth the man who drinketh wine, my children. Herein is discretion in drinking wine. A man may drink so long as he preserveth modesty. So we saw, I think Barbara was asking a question the other day. Barbara was asking a question about whether it's okay to drink wine. And Judah is telling us the answer here. He says, much discretion needeth the man who drinketh wine. Herein is the discretion. A man may drink so long as he preserveth modesty. In other words, so that he's not drunk. As long as he's not a drunkard. But you know when people drink and they start acting silly? That's not preserving modesty. That's his point. If you drink to the point where you're not preserving modesty, then you've sinned. So he says, but if he go beyond this limit, the spirit of deceit attacketh his mind and maketh the drunkard to talk filthily and to transgress, and not to be ashamed, but even to glory in his shame and account himself honorable. He that committeth fornication is not aware when he suffers loss, and is not ashamed when put to dishonor. For even though a man be a king and commit fornication, he is stripped of his kingship by becoming the slave of fornication, as I myself also suffered. For I gave my staff, that is, the stay of my tribe, and my girdle, that is, my power, and my diadem, that is, the glory of my kingdom. Remember, earlier Jacob told him in prophecy that he's going to be a king, and he received a staff and a diadem and special royal garments, but he gave those away in whoring, fornication with Tamar, because he was drunk. So drunkenness causes even a king to lose his kingdom. A serious warning even for the kings. Kings are not above the laws of the world we live in. If they do stupid things, it's going to come around to hurt them too. Just like we see in so many times with the politics, the politicians, of people who do ridiculous things, they do sexual sins, and then they get caught, and they have to forfeit their political career. it's a similar idea. They are being led astray by this, and they lose their kingdom or their political power. And so Judah says, "Indeed, I repented of these things. Wine and flesh I eat not until my old age, nor did I behold any joy." So he was fasting and mourning in repentance for sin that he did. He says, "And the angel of God showed me that forever do women bear rule over king and beggar alike. And from the king they take away his glory, and from the valiant man his might, and from the beggar even that little which is the stay of his poverty. So no matter what way of life you are, no matter what class you're in, if you're poor, you're rich, whatever, you follow the same temptations, you are not invincible to the temptation of woman. And the same thing for woman with men. The temptation to fornicate and sin sexually is with us all. So we have to not take account of how much money we have. It can happen to us, no matter who we are. And just so for those who are here, I really recommend, who joined recently, I just really recommend you listen to last week's teaching. It was really powerful. And also the teaching before that was good too. We're doing a series on the writings of Jacob's 12 sons. They each wrote a writing about their life and giving instructions and advice to their families. This is called the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs. And we've already done two teachings, two studies where we've covered five sons of Jacob, their prophecies and their instructions to their children. And now we're covering Judah's, and we're also going to be covering Joseph's as well, hopefully. So continuing with Judah's teaching, he says, "Observe, therefore, my children, the limit in wine, for there are in it four evil spirits, of lust, of hot desire, of profligacy, of filthy lucre. If ye drink wine in gladness, be ye modest with the fear of God. For if in gladness the fear of God departeth, then drunkenness ariseth, and shamelessness stealeth in. But if you would live soberly, do not touch wine at all, lest ye sin in words of outrage, and in fightings and slanders, and transgressions of the commandments of God, and ye perish before your time." He's saying it's okay to drink wine because it's such a temptation. It can lead you into major problems. It might just be best just to avoid it. If you are able to do it, just avoid it because it so easily leads to these problems. And just to give some background information, I accept many books of scripture. One of them is Third Baruch. I trust the information in Third Baruch, but Third Baruch isn't as reliable as other books. But so the information I'm telling you, I trust, but just letting you know that clarifier, it's possible it's inaccurate. But so Third Baruch says that basically the tree of knowledge of good and evil was the vine. And then after the flood happened, Noah found the vine plant from the tree knowledge of good and evil. And he was wondering, what is this plant? And then Raphael the angel, came down and told him, he told him what it was. This is the, from the knowledge of good and evil, which your forefathers ate of and sinned in doing so. But now, God has decided to transform this plant into something you guys are now allowed to have. You are now having permission to have it. However, be warned of its dangerous side effects. That if you, about drunkenness, but there was also a prophecy of the Messiah through the wine and stuff like that. In some of the manuscripts, there's a prophecy of that. But so basically, I believe something similar to that is the case, that wine and wine originated ultimately from that forbidden tree. It was changed so that we could now have it, but it still has that danger in it, which, just like Adam and Eve were led into sin and it corrupted the whole world, wine, when you abuse it and become drunk, you can corrupt so much of the world through your sins. So it's a very good idea to avoid wine if possible. I'm a Nazarite. I took the vow of the Nazarite. It's mentioned in the book of Numbers. And basically you decide to give up wine for the duration of your vow. And so I don't drink wine and I don't enjoy wine. I've almost never had it. So you could, the scriptures teach though that wine is something very enjoyable. It's kind of like sex where it's a very pleasing thing, but it can also be very destructive. And so you can have a blessed life without any sexual relations with anyone. But a lot of people think, they say, there's no point in living if you can't have sex or whatever. You know, that's what some people think. The scriptures say something similar about wine. It says something like, what is life without wine? You know, that type of thing. So basically, I know from the scriptures that this could be something really enjoyable, even though when I've had it in the past a little bit, it didn't seem that enjoyable to me. But I trust the scripture, what it says, knowing, oh, it's something that probably could be pretty awesome. But I'm going to stay away from it. For a Nazarite vow, it's a holier thing to abstain from it. You set yourself apart from it. So to be holy, you can abstain from wine, but it's not a sin to have wine in moderation if you do it according to the law. Because according to the law in Leviticus, it tells us you have to wait for 3 years before you can, it has to be the fourth year before you can drink wine from the vine. It explains it in the law of basically the tree has to be at over 3 years old, otherwise its fruit is forbidden and you can't eat it. And it applies to wine. So, and that's why Daniel was also not having the wine of the Gentiles, because it was unclean to him. That's in Daniel chapter 1 and 2, I think. And so we see it's not a sin like some of the Baptists say, but it's also a wise thing if you avoid it if possible. And now Judah says, moreover, here's something very amazing. This is a very cool thing. He says, moreover, wine revealeth the mysteries of God and men, even as I also revealed the commandments of God and the mysteries of Jacob, my father, to the Canaanitish woman Bathsheba, which God bade me not to reveal. So basically, just like I've said before about the secrets, there's secrets of the truth, like the Apocrypha. There's the secret books, they're scripture, but they're not to be shared with everybody. And there's certain mysteries and teachings that come from God, Yahuwah, which we're not supposed to be sharing with everybody because they're holy teachings. You're not supposed to cast your pearls before a swine, that type of thing. When he was drunk, he was sleeping with Bathsheba. When he was sleeping with Bathsheba, he was talking with her about some of the mysteries of, let me tell you something really awesome that happened to me before, or something God told me, you know. And basically she's a pagan Canaanite woman who is thoroughly wicked, and you're desecrating the command by telling her these secrets that she has no right to know. She's not pure enough to know these things. So that is what Judah's teaching us. Is a very important lesson. Now he says, wine is also a cause of war and confusion. And so he says, now I command you, my children, not to love money, nor to gaze upon the beauty of woman, because for the sake of money and beauty I was led astray to Bathsheba, the Canaanite. For I know that because of these two things shall my race fall into wickedness. Now he's switching to prophecy now for the Jews, his descendants. He says, for I know that because of these two things, lust and greed, because of these two things shall my race fall into wickedness. He says, for even wise men among my sons shall they mar, and shall cause the kingdom of Judah to be diminished, which the Lord gave me because of my obedience to my father. For I never caused grief to Jacob my father. For all things whatsoever he commanded, I did. And Isaac, the father of my father, blessed me to be king in Israel. And Jacob further blessed me in like manner. And I know that from me shall the kingdom be established. So he tells us how he became king. It was because he was such an obedient man to his father. And Jacob saw in prophecy, this is a good, obedient son. He loves his father, Jacob. Remember, Jacob was really blessed. So Judah was rewarded with the kingdom for being so good to his father. Those who blessed Jacob were blessed themselves. So that's the principle here. Hold on. Let me see if someone's trying to join. Okay, no one's trying to join. So continuing now. It's interesting what he says. He says, for even wise men among my sons shall they mar. So even if you're wise, it can mar you. It can lead you astray. Just like Solomon. King Solomon was led astray by fornication and money. And I have not been led astray by money, but I've been led astray in the past by sexual sin from my own experience. And so I can testify to, even though I have a lot of wisdom and knowledge, it doesn't mean that I've lived the best life. I've done things I shouldn't have done sins. And so Judah's warnings are very much relevant and applicable to our lives, I feel. He says, continues and says, I know what evils you will do in the last days. Beware, therefore, my children, of fornication and the love of money, and hearken to Judah your father. For these things withdraw you from the law of God, and blind the inclination of the soul, and teach arrogance, and suffer not a man to have compassion upon his neighbor. They rob his soul of all goodness, and oppress him with toils and troubles, and drive away sleep from him, and devour his flesh. And he hindereth the sacrifices of God, and he remembereth not the blessing of God. He hearkeneth not to a prophet when he speaketh. He resenteth the words of godliness. For he is a slave to two contrary passions, and cannot obey God, because they have blinded his soul, and he walketh in the day as in the night. Also, something very interesting, the Damascus document, after quoting the Testament of Levi, this is Judah's Testament, but after quoting the Testament of Levi, says, Levi speaks of the three traps they'll fall into, and one of them is fornication, and the other is greed, and the other is defiling the sanctuary. But those two, fornication and greed, are the same thing that Judah is talking about right here. So we see that those are key issues that are the primary downfall of humanity. He says, my children, the love of money leadeth to idolatry. I've heard many people say money is their idol or their god. You know, for people who are very rich and only care about their money, we see something very similar to idolatry. And he says, because when led astray through money, men name as gods those who are not gods, and it causeth him who hath it to fall into madness. People who, about money, they get crazy and insane, and they'll do all kinds of wicked things just for money. It drives you crazy. If you let it. He says, for the sake of money I lost my children, had not my repentance and my humiliation and the prayers of my father been accepted, I should have died childless. But the God of my fathers had mercy on me, because I did it in ignorance. And the prince of deceit blinded me, and I was ignorant as a man and as flesh, because being corrupted through sins, and I learned my own weakness while thinking myself invincible. That's exactly what we see. We, as a youth, you think you're invincible. Then you wake up to the real world and you experience harshly the real world. And that's what happened with Judah. And David too. King David, you know, he thought he was invincible, and he could take Bathsheba and not be held accountable to that. He found out the hard way. That's not the case. So, and then Judah speaks about the two spirits of, he says, know therefore, my children, that two spirits weigh upon man, the spirit of truth and the spirit of deceit. I was mentioning earlier about the two angels. That's basically the same thing that he's talking about. And So he says, and in the midst of is the spirit of the understanding of the mind, to which it belongeth to turn whithersoever it will. And the works of truth and the works of deceit are written upon the hearts of men, and each one of them the Lord knoweth. And there is no time at which the works of men can be hid, for on the heart itself have they been written down before the Lord. And the spirit of truth testifieth all things, and accuseth all. And the sinner is burnt up by his own heart, and cannot raise his face to the judge. His own heart and conscience convicts him of his sin. He says, I command you, love Levi, that ye may abide and exalt not yourselves against him, lest ye be utterly destroyed. If you oppose the priesthood, you're going to be destroyed, he's saying. For to me, the Lord gave the kingdom, to Judah, that is, and to him, Levi, the priesthood. Yeah, the two spirits are angels. They're a type of angels. Because they're different kinds. And the angels that are inside you are different than regular ones. So, he says, and to him, Levi, the priesthood, and he set the kingdom beneath the priesthood. And in the Dead Sea Scrolls, we see always the distinction between kingdom and priesthood, how the priesthood is always above. It's always higher authority and more important. So he says, to me, he gave the things upon the earth. To him, the things in the heavens. So the kingdom is an earthly thing. The priesthood is heavenly. Levi has the heavenly role. Judah has that kingly role. He says, as the heaven is higher than the earth, so is the priesthood of God higher than the earthly kingdom, unless it falleth away through sin from the Lord and is dominated by the earthly kingdom. For the angel of the Lord said unto me, the Lord chose him rather than thee to draw near to him and to eat of his table and to offer him the first fruits of the choice things of the sons of Israel, but thou shalt be king of Jacob. So he was told by an angel that he would be the king, but that Levi would be the priest. He says, and thou shalt be amongst them as the sea. For as on the sea, just and unjust are tossed about, some taken into captivity, while some are enriched, so also shall every race of men be in thee. Some shall be impoverished, being taken captive, and others grow rich by plundering the possessions of others. For the kings shall be as sea monsters. They shall swallow men like fishes. The sons and daughters of free men shall they enslave. Houses, lands, flocks, money shall they plunder. And with the flesh of many shall they wrongfully feed the ravens and the cranes. And they shall advance in evil, in covetousness, uplifted. And there shall be false prophets like tempests, and they shall persecute all righteous men. And the Lord shall bring upon them divisions one against another. And there shall be continually wars in Israel. And among men of another race shall my kingdom be brought to an end, until the salvation of Israel shall come. Until the appearing of the God of righteousness, that Jacob and all the Gentiles may rest in peace. He's prophesying of, I think it's the Romans, who bring an end to his kingdom, and prophesies about the Messiah coming. He says, he shall guard the might of my kingdom forever. For the Lord sware to me with an oath that he would not destroy the kingdom from my seed forever. That's what we see in the Tanakh. In the book of Jeremiah, we see Jeremiah 30, I think it is, around there. He says he made a covenant with David that forever he would never lack a seed from his line to rule over the kingdom of Judah. So it's the same thing here. Judah was promised that with an oath that his kingdom would not be destroyed forever. And he says, now I have much grief, my children, because of your lewdness and witchcrafts and idolatries which ye shall practice against the kingdom, following them that have familiar spirits, diviners, and demons of error. Ye shall make your daughters singing girls and harlots, and ye shall mingle in the abominations of the Gentiles. When it says singing girls, it's basically the scriptures indicate that women, you know, like basically singers, as we see today, a lot of the singers are basically whores, and we're seeing that in our society, like Miley Cyrus and so many others. She came first to my mind because she's probably the worst of them all. So basically we're seeing, you know, not just harlots, but also the singing girls. The Jews will make their daughters into singing girls and harlots. And ye shall mingle, he says, in the abominations of the Gentiles, which we see exactly happened as foretold. He says, for which things sake, the Lord shall bring upon you famine and pestilence, death on the sword, beleaguering by enemies and revilings of friends, the slaughter of children, the rape of wives, the plundering of possessions, the burning of the temple of God, the laying waste of the land, the enslavement of yourselves amongst the Gentiles. So basically what the law of Moses says, if you disobey the law, all these curses will come upon you. It's the same type of curses here we see that Judah is prophesying of. Talks about the temple of God being burned. That's exactly what's foretold in the scriptures and what happened. So he knew by prophecy this would happen and that they would be enslaved amongst the Gentiles. He says, and they shall make some of you eunuchs for their wives. Until the Lord visit you, when with perfect heart ye repent and walk in all his commandments, and he bring you up from captivity among the Gentiles. So we see today they are still in exile mostly, but until the Lord visits them and repents when they repent with their heart and start walking his commandments, then they will be brought up from captivity and be restored to the land of Israel. He says, and after these things shall a star arise to you from Jacob in peace. Remember the book of Numbers? And as last week we discussed, Levi has a prophecy about the star connected with the Messiah. Here we see, after these things shall a star arise to you from Jacob in peace. And a man shall arise from my seed like the son of righteousness, walking with the sons of men in meekness and righteousness, and no sin shall be found in him. And the heavens shall be opened unto him to pour out the Spirit, the blessing of the Holy Father. And he shall pour out the Spirit of grace upon you, and ye shall be unto him sons in truth, and ye shall walk in his commandments first and last. This branch of God Most High, and this fountain giving life unto all. Then shall the scepter of my kingdom shine forth, and from your root shall arise a stem, and from it shall grow a rod of righteousness to the Gentiles, to judge and to save all that call upon the Lord. So this is all an amazing prophecy of the Messiah. And then he says, after these things shall Abraham and Isaac and Jacob arise unto life, and I and my brethren shall be chiefs of the tribes of Israel, Levi first, I the second, Joseph third, Benjamin fourth, Simeon fifth, Issachar sixth, and so all in order. And the Lord blessed Levi, and the angel of the presence, Lord blessed Levi, and the angel of the presence, me, the powers of glory, Simeon, the heaven, Reuben, the earth, Issachar, the sea, Zebulun, the mountains, Joseph, the tabernacle, Benjamin, the luminaries, Dan, Eden, Naphtali, the sun, Gad, the moon, Asher. He was talking about the blessings. So the Lord was blessing Levi, Yahuwah himself, because Levi is the highest. And then Judah was blessed by the angel of the presence. That's the second highest. Then there's the powers of glory, so that must be like the angels or something. Simeon's blessed by the heaven, Reuben the earth, and it goes down from there, as I said. It's a confusing passage, but that's the understanding that I get from it. Then he says, ye shall be the people of the Lord and have one tongue, and there shall be no spirit of deceit of Belial, for he shall be cast into the fire forever. That's a prophecy. Hasn't happened yet. And they who have died in grief shall rise in joy, and they who were poor for the Lord's sake shall be made rich. And they who are put to death for the Lord's sake shall awake to life. So it's basically prophesying of the resurrection. All the family, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Jacob's 12 sons, all the righteous, essentially, they're going to rise and live in the millennial kingdom. And the hearts of Jacob shall run in joyfulness, and the eagles of Israel shall fly in gladness, and all the peoples shall glorify the Lord forever. Remember, the prophets speak of all the nations coming to Jerusalem once a year to keep the Feast of Tabernacles, and all the nations will cease fighting war. So we'll see there'll be peace throughout the world, and they will glorify God. He says, observe, therefore, my children, all the law of the Lord, for there is hope for all of them who hold fast unto his ways. And he said to them, behold, I die before your eyes this day, 119 years old. Let no one bury me in costly apparel, nor tear open my bowels. For this they who are kings do, and carry me up to Hebron with you. He's talking about the Egyptian practice, where, and we do this today, the embalmment. Judah's basically saying, don't embalm me. Please don't embalm me. Because in embalmment, you have to tear open their bowels and remove their organs and stuff like that and bury them in costly apparel. Funerals are expensive. He's saying, don't all do all this crazy stuff. Avoid the money stuff. Just bury me in a sufficient way. I don't want you to go to all that ridiculous stuff for me. So that is the end of Judah's Testament. And so far we are 1 hour and a half in this. And now I'm going to see if I should do Joseph's Testament this time, or if I should do Zebulun's instead. What would you guys like me to do? Joseph's Testament is 20 chapters. Chapters are small, okay? What I read through of Testament of Judah is, let's see here, it was 25 chapters. So Joseph is 20 chapters. The other one that I could read instead is Testament of Zebulun, which is 10 chapters. So what should I aim for? Do you guys think I should do Zebulun's next or Joseph's? I just want to get a gauge of what you're looking for. Joseph's, there's more amazing stuff in it, but it's takes a longer time to go through with it. So I want to base what I'm going to do based on what you guys are looking for. What about you guys? Laura would like Joseph's, but I want to see what you guys see here. Because if only one person wants to do Joseph, I don't want to do his. But if everyone wants to. Okay, I'll do with Joseph, but I'll try to go quicker than Joseph's, okay? I'll try not to do. I basically read almost the entire thing of Judah's Testament. This time, I'm just going to not read everything. I'm going to kind of only read the most important parts. But just excuse me for like less than a minute. I'm just checking on something, okay? 1 second. I'm back. My mom's gonna get me something, so I was just checking to see if she had left. So I'm gonna start with Joseph's now. Now remember, Joseph died when he was 110 years old. Joseph, he calls his sons and he says, "I have seen in my life envy and death, yet I went not astray, but persevered in the truth of the Lord." He talks about how his brothers betrayed him, and how he was innocent, and he was brought up that he wasn't killed because some of his brothers wished to kill him, but he was spared of that, and then he was put into slavery. But he was made free. So let me read this. He says, "I was sold into slavery, and the Lord of all made me free. I was taken into captivity, and his strong hand succored me. I was beset with hunger, and the Lord himself nourished me. I was alone, and God comforted me. I was sick, and the Lord visited me. I was in prison, and my God showed favor unto me. In bonds, and he released me. Slandered, and he pleased my cause. Bitterly spoken against by the Egyptians, and he delivered me. Envied by my fellow slaves, and he exalted me." And so basically, it's really interesting because scholars note that that little language that he's using is very similar to something the Messiah said in the New Testament, where it talks about how someone was naked and they were clothed. And they said, when did we ever clothe you? When you did it to them, you did it to me. For I was naked and you clothed me. And all this stuff that he says, it's very similar type of language. Scholars note that connection here. Interesting thing, observation they make. Now, Joseph gives more detail about his experience with the woman who tried to make him sin sexually. he the wife of Potiphar was trying to sleep with Joseph. And so he gives in much greater detail of his of the torment he had to go through with this woman. She would pro basically, if I was Joseph, I don't know, based on, like, in other words, in the future, I hope to be at a point where I'm, completely righteous and could resist anything. But in my former sins that I've mentioned the sexual issues in the past before, I think if a woman like this had done all the things that she did, I probably would have given in at some point because she was just crazy. But Joseph knew that was not the right thing to do. He was faithful and he refused to do it. And so I'm gonna read some of what he says. Let's see here. Well, he says it a little bit later, so I'll speak of that in a little bit. So he says, I was cast into prison, I was beaten, I was mocked, but the Lord granted me to find mercy in the sight of the keeper of the prison. For the Lord doth not forsake them that fear him, neither in darkness, nor in bonds, nor in tribulations, nor in necessities. Yeah, I mean, I hope I wouldn't, but I'm just saying, King David, he was much more righteous than me, I believe. And then look what happened to David. So it's always possible if someone like David could do it, then probably we could do it too. Hopefully we wouldn't, and we learn from these, in my youth. But now, looking forward, I hope to get to a point that it won't even be something I'll think about twice. I'll just say, no. Why, I could never do that. And I already do usually think react like that when it comes to sleeping with someone that I'm not married to. That's already a natural reaction to me. But I've never had someone persistently come to me and say, not, that must have been like torture to have to keep dealing with something like that. And Joseph tells us it was. He says. And so let me see here. He says something similar to what Paul says, as I just read. He said, "He's not the Lord does not forsake us that fear him, even in darkness and bonds and tribulations and necessities." Paul says the same thing, how he's in prison and all this stuff, but whatever. He has God, he says. You're gonna see. Yeah, she threatens with death. You'll see. Let's see here. He says, in 10 temptations, he showed me approved. So the woman tempted him 10 times. David, now we're in Joseph's testament, and we're going through and studying what Joseph went through, his experiences and the temptations he had to deal with, but how he was a righteous man and he persevered. So he says, 10 temptations he showed me approved, and in all of them I had endured. For endurance is a mighty charm, and patience giveth many good things. He says, how often did the woman, Egyptian woman, threaten me with death? How often did she give me over? Did I, yeah, Joseph, did I say what if, hopefully I said Joseph. How often did she give me over to punishment, and then call me back and threaten me? And when I was unwilling to company with her, she said to me, thou shalt be lord of me and all that is in mine house, if thou wilt give thyself unto me, and thou shalt be as our master. Kind of similar to Satan's temptation, where you'll be king and lord over all this stuff if you bow down to me and heed my will. Joseph says, but I remembered the words of my father, and going into my chamber, I wept and prayed unto the Lord. In the book of Jubilees, it says he remembered Abraham's words, and he held to Abraham's words that he taught in the book of Abraham. He says, remembering the words of my father, I went into my chamber, I wept and prayed unto the Lord. And I fasted in those 7 years. So we see fasting as a key thing to of repentance and also of resisting temptation. And I appeared to the Egyptians as one living delicately. For they that fast for God's sake receive beauty of face. And if my Lord were away from home, I drank no wine. So, once again, alcohol, wine. He knew the temptations that can come from wine, so he avoided wine when he was in situations which could escalate and lead to something. One thing leads to another. So if my Lord were away from home, I drank no wine. Nor for 3 days did I take my food, but I gave it to the poor and sick. The Shepherd of Hermas says, when you fast, you ought to give what you would have had for yourself to the poor. So Joseph's following the similar thing here. He says, and I sought the Lord early, and I wept for the Egyptian woman of Memphis. For very unceasingly did she trouble me, for also at night she came to me under pretense of visiting me. And because she had no male child, she pretended to regard me as a son. So sometimes, you know, she would come to him and treat him as if she was his own son. So he wasn't suspecting anything at first. So he said, for a time she embraced me as a son, and I knew it not. But later she sought to draw me into fornication. So she was kind of hugging him, and as like, you know, a mother would a child. And he was letting her because he wasn't realizing what was in her heart. So when I had perceived it, I sorrowed unto death. And when she had gone out, I came to myself, and I lamented for her many days, because I recognized her guile and her deceit. It's a really good concept. You should read The Shepherd of Hermas. It's a really powerful and amazing, inspiring book. It says about what riches, if you're rich, you have a major responsibility to take care of others and help others. He says, and I declared unto her the words of the Most High, if haply she would turn from her evil lust. So he tried to convince her using the commandments of God. You know, God said, don't do this, and we can't do this. Please listen. But she wouldn't listen. So he says, often therefore did she flatter me with words as a holy man, and guilefully in her talk praise my chastity before her husband, while desiring to ensnare me when we were alone. So she'd be like, when the Pharaoh was there, not Pharaoh, Potiphar, she'd say, oh, you're such a pure and, you know, you are so faithful and loyal to your master, and you're such a righteous. And then when he would go away, she said, okay, don't worry. I'm convincing him you're good. It's okay. He won't suspect a thing now because I'm making you look good. Be with me. You know, she wasn't really complimenting him with truth. She just was using that. She was lying to get her way. He says, she lauded me openly as chaste, and in secret she said unto me, fear not, my husband, for he is persuaded concerning thy chastity. For even should one tell him concerning us, he would not believe. Owing to all these things, I lay upon the ground and besought God that the Lord would deliver me from her deceit. And when she prevailed nothing thereby, she came again to me under the plea of instruction, that she might learn the word of God. So she said, I will learn God's word. I will be a faithful person. But she only used that so that she could sleep with him. And she said unto me, he says, if thou willest that I should leave my idols, lie with me, and I will persuade my husband to depart from his idols, and we will walk in the law of thy Lord. So she's saying, look, just sleep with me, and we'll abandon all our horrible sins. Don't you want us to follow God's law? Don't you want us to... Wouldn't it be better if we followed God's law? So why don't you just do this with me, and then it's the lesser sin. It's the lesser of two evils. So let's just do this so that, you know, she's trying to think of everything she could possibly think. Joseph says, and I said unto her, the Lord willeth not that those that reverence him should be in uncleanness, nor doth he take pleasure in them that commit adultery, but in those that approach him with a pure heart and undefiled lips. So he's basically saying, it's not acceptable to do this. It's not acceptable to sin for a righteous purpose. Sin to do evil so that good may come of it. Paul says, as some accuse us of saying that or doing, which God forbid, that would be evil, Paul says. Not, we don't do evil so that good can result of it. That's abomination. And God doesn't accept that kind of faith or religion. And so he says, but she held her peace, longing to accomplish her evil desire. And I gave myself yet more to fasting and prayer, that the Lord might deliver me from her. So in other words, Joseph knows, if I don't fast and pray all the time, I could easily give into this. So I'm going to just focus on God all the time, and I'm going to pour my heart into him so that I won't be led astray by this woman. He says, and again, at another time, she said unto me, if thou wilt not commit adultery, I will kill my husband by poison and take thee to be my husband. So, you know, I'm going to commit murder. If you don't want me to murder, save a man's life by sleeping with me. Isn't, you know, he basically, she might be trying to insinuate that if you don't do this with me, you're guilty of his death, which is completely perverse and wrong. She alone would be guilty of murder. Joseph should not murder someone to save someone's life. Should not commit adultery with someone to save someone's life. That would be a wicked thing to do. He says, I therefore, when I heard this, rent my garments and said unto her, woman, reverence God and do not this evil deed, lest thou be destroyed. For know indeed that I will declare this thy device unto all men. She therefore, being afraid, besought that I would not declare this device. So basically he said, if you do this, I'm going to tell everyone about you doing this, and then they're going to kill you. So don't even try it. You can listen to the rest of this on, and it'll be on YouTube. So thank you for listening to the Judah's one. I hope you enjoyed my study with Judah, and I hope you enjoy the rest of it too. Well, I'll see you later. We can talk on Facebook after if you want. But so I'll continue with those who are able to stay. He says, she departed, soothing me with gifts, and sending to me every delight of the sons of men. And afterwards she sent me food mingled with enchantments, basically love potions. Basically, there are certain foods which, like alcohol, can make you under the influence where you'll be more inclined to do something. And so she knew that, and she was trying to use magic potions. And when the eunuch, he says, who brought it came, I looked up and beheld a terrible man giving me with a dish a sword. And I perceived that scheme was to beguile me. I believe love potions are real, but there's different things. Like there's actual magic that people can do. But then there's stuff that's not magic. It's more like drugs. It's basically drugs. The ancients knew about drugs, and the moderns know about drugs as well. And, you know, there's so many different drugs that cause people to do all kinds of crazy things. Like, some people sleepwalk, you know, so there could probably be a drug to make you sleepwalk. There could be a drug to make you extremely attracted to someone. Or, you know, to... There are some people who have a condition, a health condition, which makes them have an erection all the time, 24/7. And some people, normal people, cannot have that many orgasms. Like, there's a design, naturally, which once you have one, there's a waiting period, and you can't have that many in a day. That's the healthy way to do it. But there are some people who they have a disease which makes it so that almost the tiniest little thing can set them off and give them an orgasm, and they have like hundreds a day. This is a thing I've heard about. This is a real thing, and people suffer this, and they feel horrible about it and miserable. They can't control it. You know, they said, I watched a documentary on it, and they said, the people who suffer with this, they said, other people who never experienced this would say when hearing this, that's a dream come true or something. For some people, they might think that, but not for those who experienced it. It's a painful thing. They are so self-conscious about themselves because they almost can't go out anywhere with anyone all the time, you know, because they're always having feelings like this. And so basically there could be a drug or a potion which would make people feel highly aroused. And when you're feeling that, the hormones rushing through your body, you're much more likely to commit a sin with someone. So I do think that there is validity to the idea. Let me see. Sorry, you know, if I say things that are a little too detailed, I apologize. I'm just trying to explain the concepts to people. So hopefully I don't offend people by some of the details I say. Let's see here. Now, Joseph, when he saw this, he knew something was wrong about this. Why is this guy bringing this food to me? This seems suspicious. Or maybe he had a vision or dream that told him that this guy was bad. So he perceived that this was a scheme to beguile him. And so he says, when he had gone out, I wept, nor did I taste that, nor any other of her food. So then, after one day, she came to me and observed the food and said unto me, why is it that thou hast not eaten of the food? And I said unto her, it is because thou hast filled it with deadly enchantments. And how saidst thou, I come not near to idols, but to the Lord alone? So basically he's saying, you said you wouldn't come to near to idols, but to God alone, and yet you're using magic. Which is, that's a considered idolatry or coming from other gods. Joseph says, now therefore, know. Yeah, that's what I figured. I figured since we're all adults and, you know, I'm not saying it for a sinful reason and not going into too much detail. I just say what's sufficient to explain the concepts. He says, now therefore know that the God of my father hath revealed unto me by his angel thy wickedness, and I have kept it to convict thee, if haply thou mayst see and repent. So he said, God had revealed it to him, but he kept the food there to show her and hopefully inspire her to repent. But now this is an amazing thing what he says. He says, but that thou mayest learn that the wickedness of the ungodly hath no power over them that worship God with chastity, behold, I will take of it and eat before thee. And having so said, I prayed thus, the God of my fathers and the angel of Abraham be with me, and ate. Basically, he ate poison, essentially, or a bad thing, but wasn't harmed by it. This happens by the Apostle John. The Apostle John, in the Acts of John, he drinks poison. First, he has a convicted criminal, drink the poison, and then the convict dies, because he was on death row, so they had him do it. He died, then John drank it, and nothing happened to him, because of his faith, and he was righteous. He showed him that God's power has more power over the physical things, and then he also raised the guy who was convicted to life, and said, now that he's risen to life, I mean, now you killed him, and now he's alive again. But since you killed him, that technically fulfills the death penalty, so let him go. Let his sentence be done, and let him be a free man now. And he was let go and freed. That's in the Acts of John. And so it's a similar idea that Joseph, he was protected from it, and drank or ate this food that was polluted, and yet he was fine from it, and nothing happened to him. And the same thing we see in the New Testament, where they could pick up snakes and it wouldn't harm them. It's the same principle. So he says, when she saw this, that he ate it, and he was fine, She fell upon her face at my feet, weeping, and I raised her up and admonished her. And she promised to do this iniquity no more. Now, you know people have a double-mindedness, so they'll say at the time, and they'll be serious and mean it, I won't do it again, I promise. But then they start getting, like when someone's addicted to drugs or smoke, they'll do the sin and they'll say, I just did this. I'm never going to do this ever again. But then when they start getting their fix, they start getting withdrawal symptoms and they say, okay, I got to do this. Even though I said I would never do this again, I need to do it. And that's what happened with her. The lust started building up in her and she needed to do it. She felt she had to do it. So it says, Joseph says, but her heart was still set upon evil, and she looked around how to ensnare me. And sighing deeply, she became downcast, though she was not sick. And when her husband saw her, he said unto her, why is thy countenance fallen? And she said unto him, I have a pain at my heart, and the groanings of my spirit oppress me. And so he comforted her who was not sick. Then accordingly, seizing an opportunity, she rushed unto me while her husband was yet without. And she said unto me, I will hang myself or cast myself over a cliff if thou wilt not lie with me. She basically said, I'm going to commit suicide if you don't do this, because I can't go on anymore. This is so disturbing me that I don't even want to live anymore if I can't have you. He says, when I saw the spirit of Belial was troubling her, I prayed unto the Lord, and I said unto her, why, wretched woman, art thou troubled and disturbed, blinded through sins? Remember, if thou kill thyself, Astiho, the concubine of thy husband, thy rival, will beat thy children, and thou wilt destroy thy memorial from off the earth. And she said unto me, lo, then thou lovest me. Let this suffice me. Only strive for my life and my children, and I expect that I shall enjoy my desire also. So she misinterpreted it. She thought Joseph loved her, because he's saying, no, don't kill yourself. Don't do that. She saw, he loves me. He's trying to save my life. Joseph says, but she knew not that because of my Lord I spake thus, and not because of her. For if a man hath fallen, this is Joseph saying, for if a man hath fallen before the passion of a wicked desire and become enslaved by it, even as she, whatever good thing he may hear with regard to that passion, he receiveth it with a view to his wicked desire. Yeah, he loved her, but he wasn't in love with her. So she thought he wants to be with me or something. I don't know. She twisted it. And as Joseph said, when someone's under the influence of that wicked spirit of fornication, they twist things to make it fit what they want to hear. And we see that so often that's true with the world we live in. People want to hear what they want to be true. So they force the evidence to fit their viewpoint. And Joseph explains why that is, because we're being led astray by wicked desires, and we're enslaved by those desires and passion. So he says, I declare therefore unto you, my children, that it was about the sixth hour when she departed from me, and I knelt before the Lord all the day and all the night. And about dawn I rose up, weeping the while, and praying for release from her. At last, then, she laid hold of my garments, forcibly dragging me to have connection with her. When, therefore, I saw that in her madness she was holding fast to my garment, I left it behind and fled away naked. And holding fast to the garment, she falsely accused me, and when her husband came, he cast me into prison in his house. And on the morrow he scourged me and sent me into Pharaoh's prison. And when I was in bonds, the Egyptian woman was oppressed with grief, and she came and heard how I gave thanks unto the Lord, and sang praises in the abode of darkness, and with glad voice rejoiced, glorifying my God that I was delivered. Glorifying my God that I was delivered from the lustful desire of the Egyptian woman. And often hath she sent unto me, saying, consent to fulfill my desire, and I will release thee from thy bonds, and I will free thee from the darkness. So even when he's in jail, she's still going after him. That must have been torture. But he says, not even in thought did I incline unto her. So he wasn't even tempted by this. He didn't even consider it in his mind. He said, for God loveth him who in a den of darkness combineth fasting with chastity, rather than the man who in king's chambers combineth luxury with license. And if a man liveth in chastity and desireth also glory, and the Most High knoweth that it is expedient for him, he bestoweth this also upon him, even as upon me. And then he goes a little bit more. He says, how often, though she were sick, did she come down to me at unlooked for times, and listened to my voice as I prayed. And when I heard her groanings, I held my peace. So she was moaning and groaning. And he says, for when I was in her house, she was wont to bare her arms and breasts and legs that I might lie with her. For she was very beautiful, splendidly adorned in order to beguile me. And the Lord guarded me from her devices. So basically, you know, there's this really attractive woman, and she's basically stripping herself naked to Joseph, trying to seduce him. A lot of men would fall prey to that. But Joseph, because he was a very righteous, holy man, he always thought of the Lord of God first. And so he clung to Yahuwah rather than giving in to the temptations here. So he's the chief model of piety and purity of our bodies and sexuality. So we really, when people are struggling with these sins, we should really be pointing them to Joseph to help them see what he did and learn from his ways. Learn that he avoided these things by focusing on righteousness and fasting and praying. If you're not fasting and praying and focusing on godly things, then you're going to fall into temptation and sin. So he says, you see, therefore, my children, how great things patience worketh and prayer with fasting. So ye too, if ye follow after chastity and purity with patience and prayer, with fasting and humility of heart, the Lord will dwell among you because he loveth chastity. And wheresoever the Most High dwelleth, even though envy or slavery or slander befalleth, the Lord who dwelleth in him for the sake of his chastity not only delivereth him from evil, but also exalteth him even as me. For in every way the man is lifted up, whether in deed or in word or in thought. My brethren knew how my father loved me, and yet I did not exalt myself in my mind. Although I was a child, I had the fear of God in my heart, for I knew that all things would pass away. And I did not raise myself with evil intent, but I honored my brethren, and out of respect for them, even when I was being sold, I refrained from telling the Ishmaelites that I was the son of Jacob, a great man and a mighty. Basically, he was protecting his brothers the way people tell the story, they make Joseph seem like a boastful, proud, arrogant guy. Look how awesome I am. But that's not how it was. That's a distortion of the truth. Joseph was a very humble man, and he was just telling the truth about, you know, I had dreams about me. And the brothers interpreted it as him being so full of himself, but that's not what it was. He was just declaring the word of God, the dreams he had. And he honored his brothers. And so when he was being sold, he didn't say, help, don't listen to them, I'm not a slave. He said, he basically went along with it to protect his brothers. Joseph explains that later on. He says, have the fear of God in all your works before your eyes, and honor your brethren, for every one who doeth the law of the Lord shall be loved by him. He says, when I came to the Indo-Kalpita, I'm not sure what that is, with the Ishmaelites, they asked me, saying, art thou a slave? And I said that I was a home-born slave, that I might not put my brethren to shame. The eldest of them said unto me, thou art not a slave, for even thy appearance doth make it manifest. But I said that I was their slave. Now, when we came into Egypt, they strove concerning me which of them should buy and take me. This is kind of similar to what happened with the Apostle Thomas. The Apostle Thomas, he was told to go into India, and he said, no, I don't want to go into India. And then, the Messiah appeared, and he went to one of the Indian men and said, look here, I have a slave that I'm going to sell to you guys. This is my slave, Thomas, and I'm going to sell him to you guys. Is that okay? And Thomas, because this is the Messiah, he can't say, no way, I'm going to disobey you. So he, just like Joseph, he said, yes, I am a slave, and So he went along with it. And the same thing, Joseph went along with it because he knew that's what God's will was, that he should be enslaved. He did it for righteousness. He allowed himself to be in slavery for that purpose. Let's see. And then he says, I'm going to skip some of this stuff. He gives more details about how he was being sold and purchased by different people. He says, about that time, the Memphian woman, the wife of Pentapherus, came down in a chariot with great pomp because she had heard from her eunuchs concerning me. And she told her husband that the merchant had become rich by means of a young Hebrew. And because Joseph, when he was with the merchant, was blessed. And he got a lot of money. So she had heard about it. And then she said, he says that she told her husband that they say that he had assuredly been stolen out of the land of Canaan. Now therefore, render justice unto him, and take away the youth to thy house, so shall the God of the Hebrews bless thee, for grace from heaven is upon him. And Pentapherus, I think that's Potiphar, was persuaded by her words, and commanded the merchant to be brought, and said unto him, what is this that I hear concerning thee, that thou stealest persons out of the land of Canaan, and sellest them for slaves? But the merchant fell at his feet, and besought him, saying, I beseech thee, my lord, I know not what thou sayest. So basically, he didn't believe him, so he decided to, he commanded that he should be, the merchant should be stripped and beaten because for stealing a slave. But when he persisted, he said, bring the youth up, and Joseph was brought up, and he did obeisance to Potiphar because he was third in rank in the officers of Pharaoh. That's what Joseph tells us. And Joseph says, he took me apart from him and said unto me, art thou a slave or free? And I said, a slave. And he said, whose? And I said, the Ishmaelites. And he said, how didst thou become their slave? And I said, they bought me out of the land of Canaan. And he said unto me, truly thou liest. And straightway he commanded me to be stripped and beaten. Now the Memphian woman was looking through a window at me while I was being beaten. I said bitten, sorry. For her house was near, and she sent unto him, saying, thy judgment is unjust, for thou dost punish a free man who hath been stolen, as though he were a transgressor. And when I made no change in my statement, though I was beaten, he ordered me to be imprisoned until he said the owners of the boy should come. And the woman said unto her husband, wherefore dost thou detain the captive and well-born lad in bonds, who ought rather to be set at liberty and be waited upon? For she wished to see me out of a desire of sin, but I was ignorant concerning all these things. So even when he was first there, she longed, like, it was not a coincidence that he wound up there in that guy's house. She wanted it to happen. She was planning it all along. So this was a really long scheme that she had. So he said to her, it is not the custom of the Egyptians to take away that which belongeth to others before proof is given. This therefore he said concerning the merchant, but as for the lad, he must be imprisoned. Now Joseph says, after 24 days came the Ishmaelites, for they had heard that Jacob my father was mourning much concerning me. And they came and said unto me, how is it that thou saidst thou was a slave? And lo, we have learnt that thou art the son of a mighty man in the land of Canaan, and thy father still mourneth for thee in sackcloth and ashes. When I heard this, my bowels were dissolved, and my heart melted, and I desired greatly to weep. But I restrained myself, that I should not put my brethren to shame, and I said unto them, I know not, I am a slave. For a second, let me just tell you guys, I'm really close to the end of Joseph's testament, so if you have to go soon, try to save for the rest of this. Joseph continues and says, then therefore they took counsel to sell me, that I should not be found in their hands. For they feared my father, lest he should come and execute upon them a grievous vengeance. For they had heard that he was mighty with God and with men. Then said the merchant unto them, release me from the judgment of Potiphar, or Pentapherus. And they came and requested me, saying, Say that thou wast bought by us with money, and he will set us free. People are asking questions. I believe they picked up snakes. But the reason they did that is not to just say, oh, cool, look at me, I pick up snakes, which a lot of people are doing today. But when there are snakes infested in an area, they can pick them up to get them out of the way, or to save someone else's life, pick them up and not be harmed by it. So it's a protection of themselves and other people. And then a guiding angel. I think an angel could teach you. The Holy Spirit is the principal teacher, but I think angels could teach, because that's what we see in scriptures. We see angels teaching Moses, Enoch, and all different kind of things, where angels are the mediators between God and man. So now, continuing with Joseph's testament, he says, the Memphian woman said to her husband, buy the youth, for I hear, said she, that they are selling him. And straightway she sent a eunuch to the Ishmaelites and asked them to sell me. But since the eunuch would not agree to buy me, he returned, having made trial of them, and he made known to his mistress that they asked a larger price for their slave. And she sent another eunuch, saying, even though they demand 2 minae, give them, do not spare the gold, only buy the boy and bring him to me. The eunuch therefore went and gave them 80 pieces of gold, and he received me. But to the Egyptian woman he said, I have given 100. And though I knew, I held my peace, lest the eunuch should be put to shame. Basically, Joseph says, the eunuch lied about how much he bought. He kept some of the money for himself. But I'm not going to say anything about this, because I don't want to get him in trouble. Because she's going to overreact, and she's going to do something to harm him, and that's not right. So to protect him, he's a good man, I'm going to protect him so that he doesn't get punished on my account. So Joseph says, you see therefore, my children, what great things I endured, that I should not put my brethren to shame. Do ye also therefore love one another, and with long suffering hide ye one another's faults. For God delighteth in the unity of brethren, and in the purpose of a heart that taketh pleasure in love. And when my brethren came into Egypt, they learnt that I had not returned, that I had returned their money unto them, and upbraided them not, and comforted them. After the death of Jacob my father, I loved them more abundantly, and all things whatsoever he commanded, I did very abundantly for them. And I suffered them not to be afflicted, even in the smallest matter. And all that was in my hand I gave unto them. And their children were my children, and my children as their servants, and their life was my life, and all their suffering was my suffering, and all their sickness was my infirmity. My land was their land, and their counsel my counsel. And I exalted not myself among them in arrogance because of my worldly glory, but I was among them as one of the least. If ye also therefore walk in the commandments of the Lord, my children, he will exalt you there, and will bless you with good things forever and ever. And if anyone seeketh to do evil unto you, do well unto him, and pray for him, and ye shall be redeemed of the Lord from all evil. So that's, you know, similar to what the Messiah said, pray for those who do evil against you, and you don't do evil for evil. And how Joseph said to not put your brothers to shame, and don't reveal things about them to their negative punishment, is basically not to protect them from what they deserve, but to, for the sake of loving them, so that they aren't, that people don't sin against them because of the bad things they did. You are trying to look out for your family, and also for other people, trying to protect them from injustice, and sometimes that requires concealing what people have done, so that they are not sinned against. And so Joseph says, for behold, you see that out of my humility and long-suffering I took unto wife the daughter of the priest of Heliopolis, and 100 talents of gold were given me with her, and the Lord made them to serve me. And he gave me also beauty as a flower beyond the beautiful ones of Israel, and he preserved me unto old age in strength and in beauty, because I was like in all things to Jacob. So basically he was very beautiful, just as Genesis says he was attractive. And that's why she was so wanting to, that was why the woman was so wanting to be with him, because he was a very attractive man. And he says he had said that he, with humility and long suffering, he took the wife of the priest, the daughter of the priest of Heliopolis. Genesis mentions he married Asenath, the daughter of the pagan priest, but he doesn't explain how that happened. And Joseph says with long suffering this happened. And in the account of Joseph and Asenath, we see great detail about how this happened and how with long suffering and humility, he waited until she purified herself for him and abandoned idols on her own. It took a while, but she decided to do it. And let's see here. Okay, then there's a prophecy that Joseph has about 12 hearts. 9 of them were dispersed, he said. Now the 3 were preserved, but on the following day they also were dispersed. He's talking about the 12 tribes of Israel and how they were sent into exile. And he says, and I saw that the 3 hearts became 3 lambs, and they cried up to the Lord. They cried to the Lord, and he brought them forth into a flourishing and well-watered place. Yea, he brought them out of darkness into light. That's when the 3 tribes returned back into the land after the exile. That was when the decree of Cyrus was sent out, and they could return. The exiles could return, but only the 3 tribes returned. And there they cried unto the Lord until there gathered together to them the 9 hearts, and they became as 12 sheep. And after a little time, they increased and became many flocks. So it's the restoration of Israel that he's prophesying of. And he says, and after these things I saw and beheld, 12 bulls were sucking 1 cow, which produced a sea of milk, and there drank thereof the 12 flocks and innumerable herds. I think that's the Gentiles. The innumerable herds and many flocks. Or maybe it's the descendants of the tribes. And so he says, the horns of the 4th bull went up into heaven and became as a wall for the flocks. And in the midst of the 2 horns, there grew another horn. And I saw a bull calf which surrounded them 12 times. And it became a help to the bulls wholly. And I saw in the midst of the horns a virgin. I think some of the manuscripts differ in this passage. But it's basically a prophecy of the Messiah. So a virgin wearing a many-colored garment, and from her went forth a lamb. And on his right, as it was as it were, a lion, and all the beasts and all the reptiles rushed against him, and the lamb overcame them and destroyed them. And the bulls rejoiced because of him, and the cow and the hearts exulted together with them. And these things must come to pass in their season, Joseph says. So it's a prophecy of the future, of the Messiah coming. He says, do ye, my children, honor Levi and Judah, for from them shall arise the salvation of Israel, which we know is the Messiah. He says, for my kingdom which is among you shall come to an end as a watcher's hammock, which will not appear after the summer. For I know that after my death the Egyptians will afflict you, but God will avenge you, and will bring you into that which he promised to your fathers. But ye shall carry up my bones with you. For when my bones are being taken up thither, the Lord shall be with you in light, and Belier shall be in darkness with the Egyptians. And carry ye up Asenath, your mother, to the Hippodrome, and near Rachel, your mother, bury her. And when he had said these things, he stretched out his feet and died at a good old age. It says, then after, and all Israel mourned for him, and all Egypt with a great mourning. And when the children of Israel went out of Egypt, they took with them the bones of Joseph, and they buried him in Hebron with his fathers. And he was 110 years old. So that's the end of the Testament of Joseph. So you can see it has so much awesome stuff in these books. So far we've done 7 Testaments. I hope you enjoyed the information. Do you guys have any final questions before we end this? And if you really like my study and information here, I have videos on YouTube of all other kinds of stuff. Please watch. This is our 15th Bible study. We've done this once a week for 15 weeks straight. So you can please watch them all if you haven't listened to them all yet. And you can get caught up in what we've been studying. Also, you can message me on Facebook because there's so many other things that I've discovered. Some really good information. If you like what I said, and you want to hear so much more, then just message me or keep following with me, because there's many more great things to come. So it looks like that's it. It looks like no one has any questions. Once again, thank you guys for coming, and I hope you come next Sunday. It's going to be at 8 o'clock, because this week I got confused and started at 9 for some reason. It was a mix-up. So next week it's going to be at the regular time, 8 o'clock, and I really hope you enjoyed it. Shalom to you all.